Okay, sorry about the little technical difficulty there.
All right.
Hello everyone, and welcome to phyloseminar.org, a project supported by the Society of Systematic Biologists. Today is the second talk in a series of two talks on phylogenetic approaches to cancer. 2 weeks ago, we heard from Camila Nexarova, and today we'll have Roland Schwarz from Nick Goldman's group speaking on the phylogenetic quantification of intratumor heterogeneity. Roland did his undergraduate and then PhD work at the University of Würzburg, where he developed machine learning methods for the study of microbiology and graduated in 2009. Since then, he has been in Nick Goldman's group at Cambridge, working on a variety of problems using machine learning techniques. I really encourage you to take a look at his publication list, and I posted that on his on the Google Plus page for PhyloSeminar. This guy's worked on everything from theoretical models of cell size to multiple sequence alignment and now molecular evolution in cancer. He's been a Marie Curie Fellow at the EBI since 2012 and has one more year before going on the job market. Thank you for speaking, Roland, and I'm looking forward to your talk.
Great. Thanks a lot, Eric, for the nice introduction. And it's a pleasure to be here on phyloseminar.org. And do I need to activate my screen share? How does this work?
Yeah, so just go ahead and turn on your screen share like we did.
Mm-hmm. Is that Perfect. Coming through?
Yeah, lovely.
Very good. Well, thanks a lot. Actually, before, as a few words of introduction, before I started here at the EBI in Hingston with Nick Goldman. I worked with Florian Markowitz at the Cancer Research UK Institute in Addenbrookes in Cambridge, also at the University of Cambridge. And most of the work that I'll be talking about is kind of a joint venture between my work, what I did there, and now what I do here with Nick Goldman at the EBI. And it's mostly going to be about a clinical study on ovarian cancer, specifically high-grade serous ovarian cancer, that we did in collaboration with James Brenton, a clinical oncologist at Addenbrookes Hospital. And James approached me with an interesting project asking that, so he had this clinical study of ovarian cancer patients from the hospital that were sampled at multiple different physical sites as well at multiple time points in the course of treatment, and he was looking for a way of reconstructing the evolutionary history of cancer within these patients. And we realized that there are not a lot of methods out there that can do this for copy number profiles, which is what high-grade serous ovarian cancer is very rich in. And so this is how the whole project started. I will give an overview of the clinical data as well as the method that we developed and how we can reconstruct evolutionary histories from copy number profiles, how we can use those and some certain properties of our method to quantify numerically the degree of clonal expansion and heterogeneity in these cancers, and how this correlates to patient survival and resistance development. So the method that I'm going to talk about, which is the core part of this work, is called MEDIC, which is short for minimum event distance for intra-tumor copy number comparison, and is also publicly available from Bitbucket and if you're working in the cancer field, I would be glad if you could check it out. So intratumor heterogeneity has received a lot of attention recently in the cancer genomics field. And of course, the concept itself is not very new. It was Novak in the 70s that came up with the idea originally. It is, of course, since a very long time known that there is a lot of heterogeneity within the population when it comes to cancer. So cancer is a very patient-specific disease, which is indicated here on the right. So even the same type of cancer, say breast cancer, if you look at different patients, they will have different somatic mutations, different genome rearrangements that make kind of create a unique fingerprint of that disease in that very patient. But of course, heterogeneity goes further. So if you take a single patient and compare different biopsies, samples taken from spatially separate sites within the patient, and look at the genomic content of those individual physical samples, you will realize that of course, they are also not the same. There is a lot of intra-tumor, intra-patient heterogeneity, both on the spatial level that the genomic profiles of metastases in different organs might be different, as well as on the temporal level that the cancer actually changes in the course of disease progression from the initial biopsies in the course of chemotherapy treatment to, as in our case, then the surgery samples that we retrieved. Of course, the story goes on. So if you take one of those individual samples, one physical sample, and look more closely into it and zoom in, what is kind of indicated here in the two pictures on the right, you will realize that there is a lot of heterogeneity within a single physical sample as well. There are subpopulations, subclones of cancer cells living in the same tissue, in the same sample, that create heterogeneity both on the genetic and the tissue level. There are additional effects of the tumor microenvironment, of course, of infiltration by cells from the immune system, and so on. So the picture that we are seeing these days of cancer is that of a very heterogeneous disease on very different levels. And the part that I'm going to be focusing on in this work is that of intrapatient heterogeneity, where we mostly dealt with physical samples that were taken at spatially distinct sites from the same patient over a large cohort of patients, and also at different time points in the course of treatment. Now, many cancers are very rich in single nucleotide variants. This is kind of a known fact, but for many cancers, and especially for high-grade serous ovarian cancer, genomic rearrangements and copy number changes that are the result of those rearrangements play an even more prominent role, and this is why we were focusing our attention onto those which are a little bit more hard to model evolutionary as well. And they range from focal deletions and amplifications to polyploidies, and of course, which has recently received quite a lot of attention, chromotripsis, which is the shattering of the whole genome in one catastrophic event that can lead to very, very rugged and skewed copy number profiles where many rearrangement events happen at the same time. Now, why is heterogeneity so important? Well, the idea and the hypothesis that is associated with this concept of heterogeneity is that it is responsible for resistance development. And this is indicated here on a picture I took from a Nature Reviews paper by Merlo et al. And if you look into the here on the top left, if you imagine that our cancer cells within the patient are living on this what is called the fitness landscape or the mutational landscape, which is here simplified as a two-dimensional surface, where the distance in this landscape corresponds to evolutionary distance. So the cancer starts somewhere, say, with a TP53 mutation, and then throughout the course of disease progression, by replication, it accumulates more mutations and genomic rearrangements and starts to explore this landscape. Now, the z-axis here on this plot is the fitness. Some of those mutations, certain mutations might increase the fitness over chemotherapy or in response to the immune system, whereas others might reduce the fitness. So once the selection pressure sets in, you can imagine kind of a water level rising on this three-dimensional surface here. Many of the cells will get killed off, but those with a significant fitness advantage, they will survive as a minor subclone, later outgrow, repopulate the patient, and ultimately lead to a resistant relapse that will kill the patient. So heterogeneity is, at a very fundamental level, thought to be responsible for resistance development, and that is why we are so interested in, especially in a clinical context. So here on the right, this is illustrated in a little bit more detail, where you have the frequency in the population, the y-axis, and the time on the x, and whenever an event happens which might be neutral but sometimes has a fitness advantage, the clone starts to outgrow, dominate the population of cancer cells, and as time passes on, typically, especially with respect to, say, these mutator phenotypes, so changes on the genome that themselves accelerate the mutational process, heterogeneity over time in the population increases until at the very end you end up with a very complex mixture of different subclones, each of which have a different fitness advantages over others in response to certain things, such as chemotherapy, for example. So we expect diversity to be something like the sinusoid curve, which increases on average over time. So if we how can we detect heterogeneity if we are sampling physical tumor samples from a patient? So again, if we imagine that this is this very abstract and simplified evolutionary landscape, now without the fitness value, because that's probably we'll never be able to measure fitness of a cancer cell directly in the hospital, but if you imagine this is our evolutionary landscape where these cancer cells live, they start somewhere, and by subsequent replications and accumulation of mutations, they start to explore this fitness landscape gradually. There are two scenarios that are possible. The first is that there is no fitness advantage in any of the mutations, or only very little, which means once selection pressure sets in, cells will get killed off at random, more or less, by the immune system or chemotherapy. Now, in a different scenario, let's imagine there is a clear fitness advantage of, say, these two subpopulations of cancer cells. We would expect, by chance, that subpopulations that carry the fitness increasing mutation are less likely to be killed off, whereas the other cells are the ones that are more likely to die. So how do we distinguish between these two scenarios? Well, what we actually see in the end, because the dead cells, the ones that are actually killed, are rarely sampled, the picture that we see at the end from a patient is just the surviving cells. So in this case, which corresponds to scenario B, if we do see a clear local spatial clustering of individual cancer genomes in our mutational landscape, this indicates or suggests that probably there was some form of clonal expansion happening. And this is what we were trying to look for when we did our study on these ovarian cancer patients. Now, this mutational landscape distances correspond to evolutionary distances, I said, and as such, determining these evolutionary distances is the first step. Now, because we were interested in copy number profiles, here's a little overview of how the study was done. Imagine you have a patient, and then different physical samples are taken from different organs. We used Affymetrix SNP6 arrays to get allele-specific integer copy number profiles for each of those physical samples for each of the patients. So basically, you put them on the array, you get these copy number intensity plots that I will talk about on the next slide a little bit. And in the end, what you get is a readout of, this is a genome, this could be sample A, B, and C from the same patient. And you get a set of integer copy numbers that describe the copy number of each segment along the genome. Now, typically, how people reconstructed evolutionary histories from these genomes is by just counting the number of differences in some sort of Hamming distance. Now, this is a very simple example that shows this is probably not a good idea due to the horizontal dependencies that are induced by these copy number changes. What do I mean by that? Well, a genomic rearrangement event typically starts somewhere on the genome, stretches over a certain part of the genome, and then ends again, as opposed to a single nucleotide variant, which, well, by definition only affects a single nucleotide where the sites are independent. Now, if you would just count the number of differences between genome A and B here, you would say, okay, well, there are three differences here, two there, so it has a distance of 5. And if you compare genome A and C, you would say, okay, so there are 6 differences here, so it has a distance of 6. But more likely what has happened here in this toy example is that probably there was one amplification event that started here, stretched along those three segments and ended, and a second one that started here and stretched over those two segments. So actually the event distance between A and B is 2, whereas the event distance between A and C is only 1. It just happened to be that this event was a little bit longer. So dealing with these horizontal dependencies is an important aspect of reconstructing or estimating accurate evolutionary distances between copy number profiles. And of course, these events in reality don't appear as singletons. They often overlap and lead to these cascading profiles, as we will see a bit later. So these were the major challenges we had to deal with when we were developing this algorithm, and also we had to find a measure that actually quantifies heterogeneity, as I pointed out on the previous slide. So just as a brief primer for those who haven't worked with copy number profiles before, the idea is relatively simple. So the readout from a SNP array is typically two vectors of two values. One is the log R and the other is the buff. The log R is basically just a normalized intensity on the array that tells us how much total DNA was present. So here, this would correspond to a log R value of 0 in the case where we have a 2, because the diploid normal is a 2 as well. So nothing has changed here. In this segment here, where we go to a copy number of 4, you see an increase before it drops down to a copy number of 2 again. This is only part of the readout of the SNP arrays, though. The second, probably more important, is the biallelic frequency. So for each SNP probe, you can determine the ratio between the two alleles, the two parental alleles that were actually present in the cell. So in the case of a diploid, there are three options. You have a homozygous probe, which means 100% above, which means both of the alleles were of type A, and it's arbitrary what A and B is, or a value of 0%, which means both were of type B, or you have a heterozygous SNP, so that you come end up with a ratio of 0.5. Everything else, any deviation from that, is probably just noise. Of course, for copy number 4, it's slightly different. Because you have 4 copies, you can have all copies of one type, all copies of the other type. You can have 3 out of 4 copies of one type, or 1 out of 4 copies of one type, and you can have 50-50 as well. So it's the combination of these biallelic frequencies and the log R that actually allows us to not only segment these arrays into integer copy numbers, such as the total copy number given here, but also into an allele-specific copy number, meaning we know at these positions that there were probably 3 copies of one allele and 1 copy of the other allele. Unfortunately, the phasing, so the assignment of those individual probes to the physical parental alleles that came from either the mother or the father, they are unknown. So by definition, the larger of the two is called the major copy number, and the smaller of the two is called the minor copy number. Which one of those actually corresponds to a physical copy of your genome, that is unclear at that point in time. And that is a very important point that we will get to in a bit. So what are we trying to achieve? So again, from these intensities on the arrays, we get our major and minor copy numbers for each of the samples, and this is supposed to be one patient now. So we have these 5 samples from the patient, each represented by the major and the minor copy number. We want to reconstruct the evolutionary history, so reconstruct the tree, as well as reconstruct the ancestral genomes up to the last common ancestor of all, which is supposed to be the cancer precursor, because we know that the tree is rooted at the diploid normal. But before we can do this, we have to do what is called phasing, or the haplotype-specific CNV calling. We have to take the major and minor copy numbers and assign them, as indicated in the red and green colors here, to one of the two physical alleles. This is a quite difficult task, and ideally you would do that with additional external information about the linkage of the SNPs that you observe. But in the absence of that information, we were also trying to find an optimal phasing using our evolutionary criterion. So what is the evolutionary criterion we're using? Well, probabilistic inference and copy numbers is even more difficult than using a more penalty-based criterion, simply because the horizontal dependencies increase the complexity of the algorithms quite drastically. For the same reason, indels are rarely modeled in classical phylogenetic reconstruction algorithms, because of this increase in complexity. So also, because there is a very not really a kind of concise database available for copy number profiles in cancer, estimating transition probabilities or event probabilities is difficult. So we decided to go for a parsimony-inspired criterion, where we are, and that's where the name MEDIC comes from, looking for a function that computes a minimum event distance between two genomes, which is the minimum number of amplifications and deletions that you need to transform one such profile into another. And this function, this distance method, is then used for all 3 steps of the reconstruction process. So for the phasing of the alleles, for the actual reconstruction, simply by computing pairwise distances between the profiles, and then using neighbor joining to get a tree topology, as well as for the ancestral reconstruction, which ultimately also leads to the branch lengths, which then correspond to the number of events that have happened. So what does this minimum event distance look like? Just before I go into the detail, here on the left side you see another overview of how we model or we think about the genome evolution in a simplified way, of course. But the genome is made up of individual segments, and amplifications, indicated in green, and deletions, indicated in red, can happen on this genome, leading to the genomes of different length and size, of course. But what we are actually, the readout, what we are seeing is not the actual genome, but are the copy numbers. So each of those events has a corresponding effect on the copy numbers, which is typically amplification by one or a deletion by one. And it is the overlap of those events that actually lead to these highly skewed copy number profiles that you see later down here. The function or the method that we use for inferring these distances is called a finite state transducer. This is a method, or I should more say a framework of methods that is has been used heavily in natural language processing, particularly in machine translation. There are a lot of people at Google Research, and also some people here in the engineering department in Cambridge that I collaborated with and got some advice from on this project, and they're using these machines to translate natural language from one language into another. They are very close relatives of normal finite state machines, which computer science scientists should know are a very fundamental construct that are used in a lot of areas in computer science, for example for parsing regular expressions or for building compilers. So what do they do? Well, they basically consist of a set of states and transitions, and the transitions are equipped with a set of symbols, in this case an input and an output symbol, separated by a colon, in the case of a regular finite state machine, just a single symbol, and optionally a weight as well. In the case of a regular expression, there won't be any weight because you're just interested in whether a string is matched or not, so it would just be a true or false outcome in the end. But you can also put probabilities here, or in our case, penalties, scores, that describe, so that your machine in the end gives you, once you parse a string, the probability of seeing that string, then it would just be a hidden Markov model, and actually they are equivalent to hidden Markov models in that case, or it would give you a score, in our case a penalty, for a sequence, or in our case here, because we're dealing with transducers and we have two symbols, an input and an output symbol, one score for a pair of sequences. So transducers are just an extension of regular finite state machines that work on two sequences simultaneously. So a transducer takes as input two sequences and gives me a score. And this score is supposed to be our minimum event distance. And on the next few slides, I will show you on a very simple toy example how this works. So let's imagine this is our very much simplified transducer, and we start in the match state here. The first thing, these are the two genomes we want to compare, and the first pair that we encounter is a one-on-one. There's only one matching transition, which is a self-transition into the match state because nothing has happened. The weight of that transition is zero. We note on zero. On the next position, we find a 1-2 amplification. So we take the transition that corresponds to this 1-2 amplification and end up in the amplification state and note down a weight of 1. Now we're in this state here. And we look for the next pair of symbols, which is another 1-2, taking the self-transition. We stay in the amplification state, and you by now will already know where this is going. We stay for another turn in the amplification state. We return to the match state using the 1-1 and unweighted transition. We again stay in the match state here, no score taken, and then again go into the next amplification state as soon as we encounter the next event, which is counted with 1, stay for one turn, and then we're finished. The total weight is then the sum of the weights along the path, which is just 2 in this case. So we conclude that there is a distance of 2 events that have happened between these two genomes. So this is a little bit more extended version of this. If we assume that we're dealing with a maximum copy number of 4, so 5 copy number states from 0 to 4, again, the transition to the match state will just be all the possible matches that we have. The transitions to the amplification state, there should be an arrow for each of those, but that would have made the picture very messy. All the transitions to the amplification state are an increase just by one step. And again, we have the same set of transition here for the match. The same is true for the deletion, apart from one tiny difference. I can delete a 1 to a 0, which costs 1. I can never increase a 0 to a 1, and this is actually a nice aspect of these transducers. You can include these kind of simple but important biological constraints into the distance function, where once a part, a segment of the genome is completely lost, there is no way of ever regaining it. So this whole distance here, which is not yet a distance, is asymmetric, first of all. Secondly, it only models these one-step transitions. That's why we call it the one-step tree transducer T1. So how do we get from this simple machine, which actually also includes transitions from the amplification to the deletion state, because areas of like amplified areas can follow deleted areas straight away without returning to the match state. There are just some more transitions here, but in principle, this should give you the idea of how that works. So how do we get from this T1 transducer to the actual final transducer that computes our distance? Well, this is very much done in an analogy to how traditional phylogenetic inference is modeled, or evolution is modeled as a Markov chain. If you think of a homogeneous time discrete Markov chain, you have a one-step transition probability matrix that describes the probabilities of going from an A to a C in one time step, whatever the time step may be. Now, in order to get to the five-step transition probability matrix, you just multiply in matrix multiplication this matrix five times with itself. And the analog procedure in the transducers, where the transducer takes the role of the probability of the transition probability matrix, is composition, which is indicated by this little circle here. So the k-step transducer is simply the one-step transducer composed k times with itself. So what does composition mean? Well, because we're looking for the minimum distance and we're summing along the path, for those who are more familiar with this finite state machine framework, we're working on the tropical semi-ring, very much an analogy to the Viterbi approximation in HMMs. We are interested in the minimum over all intermediate sequences Y that a transducer A assigns to input sequence X with that very sequence Y, plus the score that the second transducer that we're composing with assigns to that sequence Y with the output sequence Z. Now, in our case, A and B are the same because they're both the T1 transducer. So what remains in the end is this expression down here, where the composition of all those transducers, if we do it k times, is the minimum over all those intermediate sequences of scoring the input sequence X with the output sequence Z via all these intermediate sequences that might be in between. How is that implemented in real life? A composed transducer is built by the Cartesian product between the states, and all transitions are, the product of all transitions is taken as well, but they're only kept if the output symbol of the first sequence matches the input sequence of the first transition matches the input symbol of the second transition. There is a vast literature on the internet about the different operations that are possible in transducers, and I don't think I have the time to really go in too much detail here. But if you read a little bit into it, you will realize that there is actually a very strong analogy between matrix multiplication and transducer composition. In fact, if you take a transducer with just a single state, you can perfectly map a time-discrete homogeneous Markov chain onto a single state transducer, and you will see that the transducer composition are the same as the ones that you get from matrix multiplication. The problem here is that with each composition, the number of states exponentially increases. And this is, again, the problem with these horizontal dependencies, because we, in our original transducer, we have at least three states, for one for the match, one for the amplification, and one for the deletion. This successive composition with itself will blow up the state space, which explains this high computational demand as soon as you start to model these horizontal dependencies. Exactly the same problem that you have in phylogenetic, traditional phylogenetic reconstruction with indels.
So, sorry, Roland, can I just ask you a quick question?
Sure.
So I think people in this audience are probably more familiar with pair HMMs.
Okay,
and this is obviously more general than that, but can you just say something about, like, what are the some things that you can do with these transducers that you couldn't do with pair HMMs?
Yes, so Basically, it is. They are in parts the same. So if I was working not on what I call the tropical semi-ring here, but instead I will be working with probabilities. So we would multiply along a path in a transducer. If you remember, if I go back to the example here, we were summing the weights along the path, right? Now, if these weights weren't scores but probabilities, and we multiplied the probabilities along the path, and then took the total sum over all the possible paths of going from one sequence to another, then we would exactly have a pair HMM. The advantage is that we can simply exchange that and work with different semi-rings, like in our case just the Viterbi approximation, which you could do as well in the pair HMM case, but we're also not limited to probabilities, and it has a very rich framework around for operations that you can do on those transducers, like for example the composition, which as far as I know doesn't exist for pair HMMs. I'm familiar with them, but I'm not an expert on pair HMMs. Maybe you know more, Eric.
Yeah, no, that makes perfect sense. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. So pair HMMs are kind of contained in the transducer framework, right? Okay. Right. So what we've done now by the self-composition is we have built a transducer that is still asymmetric, because it's still not possible to regain a completely lost segment of the genome, but that models basically a one-directional course of evolution to its child. So basically from the ancestor down to one of the leaf nodes. But we are interested in pairwise distances between the samples. So actually what we're interested in is the minimum number of events that we need to go from a sample back to the last common ancestor and then down to the other sample again. And again, the answer to this is transducer composition, where we compose our transducer with its own inverse. And inverse just means flipping the input and output labels. There is nothing fancy to it. So that we are capable of going from our sample up to the ancestor and then down to the other sample. Now, of course, we don't know what this ancestor is. But if we recall the definition of the transducer composition that I showed before, it says that we call this new transducer, the composed one, we call it D, for distance between sample 5 and sample 1, is the inverted transducer T composed with itself, the non-inverted version, and then evaluated at the sequences 5 and 1, which is the minimum over all intermediate sequences Z of this inverted transducer S5 against Z plus the transducer, the non-inverted Z to S1. So basically we're going from the sample to the ancestor Z over all possible ancestors and then down to the other sample again, and the minimum path that we can find, the shortest path, the minimum distance we can find up here and down there, this is our evolutionary distance, and this then is symmetric due to the composition with its inverse, very much in analogy to matrix multiplication. Again, if you multiply a matrix with its transpose, that will be a symmetric matrix as well. So this kind of closes off how we compute this minimum event distance. The resulting construct is a large transducer with a lot of states that we can use to compute these distances. Now, how do we deal with these with the allele-specific copy number assignment? How do we do the phasing that I talked about earlier? So this is a bit more difficult. The problem here is that at each position, I can freely choose either to have the major copy number as allele A or the minor copy number as allele A. So basically, at each position, I have two choices. So in the end, I have 2 to the n, where n is the length of the sequence possibilities of assigning these copy numbers to the major, to the physical allele A or B. And an example is just shown here with the red and green colors. Why does that matter? Well, if we compare those two examples here, if those two sequences, if we just said, well, my definition is major is B and minor is A, for example, completely, like the full sequence, and the total distance between the copy number profiles is just the sum of the distances of the major copy number profiles and the minor copy number profiles. Well, let's do that. Let's compare that. Major here has a difference here at the beginning. There's a 2, where here, down here, is a 1. So there's one event. Then they're identical in the next two ones. Then there is another event happening here where we see two twos as opposed to just two ones, and then they're identical again. So I would say there are two events happening between the majors. And if you compare the minor copy numbers, you'll see they're identical, so nothing's going to happen there. So I would say the total distance is two. But if you choose them in a clever way and say, well, I say allele A is actually 1111110, and allele B is actually 2002212, and down here I say allele A is also 111110, and allele B is 1001112, and just write them one under another, and the alleles concatenated, separated by this little x, just as a separator character, doesn't mean anything special, then we can explain the evolution or the change from this genome to this genome just by a single event. Because these two zeros here perfectly match these two zeros down here, and zero means the part of the genome is completely gone, a single amplification event is enough that spans over this whole region here to increase the copy number state from 10011 to 20022. So in the end, we get away with only one event as opposed to two if we did a not optimal choice of phasing. So that's why we want to do phasing. But how do we do it? Well, the problem is you cannot keep all the possible sequences in memory, because if this is more than 10, you have 2 to the, 100,000 segments or something, possible sequences, and you can't possibly evaluate them all. But what you can do is you can write them as a context-free grammar. That's what you see on the right. So this is an idea that comes from, again, of course, language modeling, but also is used in bioinformatics a lot in RNA structure prediction, where basically a context-free grammar in this grammar way of writing things consists of a non-terminal system symbols indicated by the N's and terminal symbols, which are just our copy number states. Now, you generate sequences inside out. You start with N0 and say, okay, at the first position, this would be this one here on the left, I have the option of having a 2 and then another non-terminal symbol and a 1, or 1, rest of the sequence, 2. Now, what is N1? Well, N1 is, now we are at the second position, I have the option of choosing 10 or 01. And so you can walk your way through the whole sequence till the end, then you just emit the separator character that I placed here. And this little set of rules describes all the possible choices you can have at for the possible phasing choices you can make for those two genomes. Every realization, like every concrete phasing choice that you actually make then, can be represented by this parse tree, where the blue rules are the ones that I've chosen. So we start N0 to 1, then N1 goes to 0, 1, which is the one over here. We have another 0, 1 there. And you can just follow the blue path through the grammar here, and you see that it corresponds to this tree. And then you can read off the sequence just by basically left first, walking around the tree, and coming up here. You need to invert the right of the sequence, but that's a minor problem. So instead of holding all these 2 to the n sequences in memory, we can compactly represent them with a context-free grammar. But how do we compute distances between context-free grammars with our transducers? Well, fortunately, there is an automaton representation of a context-free grammar, which is a pushdown automaton. How does that work? Again, probably won't have the time to go into too much detail, but you can imagine that in the same way that RNA structures are written down in this dot bracket notation, dots are just regular emissions for us, and we include brackets in our machine and a valid path through our machine, so a valid way of transforming one genome into another, is only then a valid path if the brackets match. So you just include a stack on which you push that's why it's called pushdown automaton, on which you push the brackets and take them off again, so that in the end you can check whether the brackets match, and then you've done your parsing on a context-free grammar as opposed to a regular grammar before. So it's actually just, it increases the computation complexity, but in principle, the idea is a very, very simple way of embedding this next higher, more complex set of grammars, the context-free grammars, into our existing framework of the transducers, just by introducing some brackets, basically, or parentheses. If we've done that, and we have this, our transducer can work on these context-free grammars, all we do is we represent a physical sample represented by the major and the minor as a grammar. We do the same with a second sample, and instead of putting two single genomes into our minimum event distance, we take these two grammars into our minimum event distance, and then compute the score and take the value that actually has this minimum score as our choice of phasing, where we say this is the phasing that minimizes the evolutionary distance. Now, of course, we don't want to do that just one against one. We want to do it jointly for all of our samples in the patient. And yes, that's actually NP-hard. But there are heuristics that we can use to deal with that quite efficiently. In our case, we just look for a center point and then look back to the individual genomes to find a good approximation of what we're looking for. And what we're looking for is an optimal choice of phasing for each of the genomes in the sense that the total sum of distances between all of them is minimal. And this is, again, just done by the same minimum evolution criterion that we used for the tree inference as well. So now that we've done that, we're actually almost there. We have now this construct, this minimum event distance, and we can use it for all three steps of our tree reconstruction. We can phase the alleles, we can compute pairwise distances between all our samples, we can then use just standard neighbor joining to get a tree, and then we can use the same evolutionary distance, actually we need our tree transducer T for that, to reconstruct the ancestral genomes very much in the same way that you would do for a maximum likelihood phylogeny ancestral reconstruction, where you basically compute the likelihoods from bottom up to the top of the tree, and then in a trace back, go back down and fix the ancestral genomes as the ones that optimally minimize the total tree length. Right. That kind of concludes the part about the core of the method, how we compute the evolutionary trees. Now, I started off by saying that we're actually interested in quantifying heterogeneity. Now, here we make use of kind of a bit of a trick. If you remember, and I might go just back a few slides, here, at this part where I said, after having built this transducer that models the one-way evolution, we compose it with its own inverse, kind of like a matrix multiplication with its own transpose. And if you remember what happens when you multiply a matrix with its own transpose, you know that the resulting matrix is not only symmetric, it's also positive semi-definite, which means all the eigenvalues will be greater than zero. And the same was proven by Corinna Cortes from Google Research, if I'm not mistaken, in 2004, who showed that if there is a transducer and you compose it with its own inverse, you know that the score defined by this transducer is a positive semi-definite kernel score, just like a Gaussian kernel or an Engram kernel used for sequences. Engram kernels are actually particular instances of these transducer kernels. And they call them rational kernels. So what does that mean? That means that the very distance matrix that we computed, which is just the number of events between the minimum event distance, the number of events we need to transform one genome into another. If we take the pointwise exponential of those, we need that because this is actually computed in on a logarithmic scale and we need to transform it back to the reals. We get a diagonal dominant matrix with ones on the main diagonal and very small numbers on the off-diagonal entries, which is symmetric and positive semi-definite, which means we can use it and out of the box do kernel principal component analysis, support vector machine classification, and a lot of other standard straightforward machine learning techniques on this kernel matrix, where you know that the feature space encoded by this kernel is such that distance in that feature space is highly correlated with evolutionary distances that we computed. And this is exactly what I said about what I said on the first slide, this mutational landscape that we were thinking about when we said, you know, our cancer cells live in this mutational landscape and spread out, and then the water rises and some die and others survive. Well, the most important property of this landscape is that distance corresponds to evolutionary distance. So the feature space induced by this kernel implicitly can be thought of as exactly that, our evolutionary landscape. We can do adjust the kernel PCA and project it down to the first two principal components to get exactly a plot like this, just without the fitness values. And just as an example, once you've done that, you end up with point clouds like these. This is one patient. These are all the genomes from the same patient. And if you see something like this, you might say, oh, there was a lot of clonal expansion. But how do you determine this? Well, there are standard methods from spatial statistics, such as Ripley's K, that take a two-dimensional point cloud and tell you whether it is uniformly distributed according to a Poisson process or whether there is local spatial clustering. And this is just what we use for determining our index for heterogeneity. We take each of our patients, we perform our evolutionary comparisons, we project it onto this mutational landscape by simple kernel PCA, we use Ripley's K out of the box and get a value that says how much local spatial clustering is there. We can also compute other things. If you have two subgroups of samples, for example, some are taken before chemotherapy and others after chemotherapy, you can take the center of mass or robust center of mass in this kernel space to compute an average distance between these subgroups, for example. So there's a lot of other things that you can do, but I don't want to focus on that too much. This is the important part, how we got to the clonal expansions. So now we're back at the clinical data, and that's what I want to close off with, tell you a little bit of the clinical results. So altogether, after quality control, we ended up with 17 patients, each of which had something between 3 and 30 samples each. Yes, there was a single patient with 30 samples, and I was found that quite astonishing as well. For each of those patients, we compute evolutionary distances and reconstruct the evolutionary history using the method that I just showed you. And then by projection onto this mutational landscape and looking for local spatial clusters, we determine an index for a spatial heterogeneity. And then we were interested in finding out how this index, or if it correlates with resistance development and survival in the clinic. We applied that these methods in that succession to all of the patients in our data set, and we could immediately see that there, just by looking at it by eye, that there are probably two clusters. There's the set, each square is now a patient, and this is our mutation landscape, and these are the genomes. And you can see that there are two major groups. One is where there is quite some local clustering here in these four genomes. A little bit more there. You can see some clustering here as well and there. There's a second group where it seemed to be the case that the points were more uniformly spread out here. You can see a bit of clustering there, but in general, the trend is that it is more uniform. Don't be fooled by the fact that there are less genomes down here. We tested for the number of samples, whether that has an effect, and it did not, on average. If you look at the trees that we reconstructed for those patients, this is reflected in the trees as well. So this is the tree corresponding to this patient here. You see a more kind of linear homogeneous type of evolution, whereas if you look up here, you see strong clades that have quite a good, I don't want to say bootstrap support, because it's not actually bootstrap what we're doing, but we're basically adding noise to the distances to see how robust they are. So has quite a good support on these clades. They are very similar to each other, but very dissimilar to the others. And they correspond to these groups that you see here. This tree is this patient. And then we looked at the clinical data. And in ovarian cancer, there is a tight correlation between the months of progression-free survival and a resistant relapse. So the clinical indicator is normal. If a patient relapses within the first 12 months, it is most likely to be of a resistant relapse type. Whereas if it takes longer to relapse, it is very likely to respond to a second line of platinum-based chemotherapy. So we looked at our survival and resistance data, and we found that almost exclusively all the patients that showed this very strong tight local clustering were of a resistant relapse type, and the other ones were sensitive. So a high degree of clonal expansion indicated a very poor outcome for those patients. Some survival analysis as well stratified patients into low clonal expansion and high clonal expansion groups, and you can see that both in terms of progression-free survival as well as an overall survival, there is a very strong and significant difference between survival in those two groups. And just as a final anecdote, we also had relapse cases for two of the patients, and they always branched very early. Ascites here is the relapse. next to the biopsy. B means biopsy from the omentum or the ovary. And in this one case, we could see that there was a focal deletion at the NF1 locus in one of the samples, especially in the relapse sample. It was very, very clear, very evident. We could not find that on the array for any of the other samples, in particular not for the biopsy or for the surgery sample here. So we did digital PCR for that particular deletion to see whether it is actually present or not. And we could find it very dominant here in the relapse. We found it in a different proportions in the other samples as well. But most interestingly, we found it in a very small percentage of cells that were included in the biopsy physical sample. And now if you remember what I said on the first slide about how even the physical samples that are spatially separate, how they contain a lot of heterogeneity, subclonal cancer populations, this highly suggests that the clone that later dominated the cancer in the end, when the patient died, that had this NF1 deletion, was already present as a minor subclone at presentation at the point when the biopsy was taken. Kind of underlining and supporting this whole heterogeneity leads to resistance development hypothesis. That is a minor subclone that outgrows, repopulates, and kills the patient. With that, I would like to thank all the people involved. My boss, Nick Goldman at the EBI, Botan Sipos, as well as from the CRI, Florian Markowitz, my previous boss, and James Branton, the clinical oncologist who did the work and who did a lot of the simulations. Some people from the engineering department who helped with the transducers, and our friends and collaborators from Canada and Vancouver, Saurabh and Gavin. And you for inviting me.
Thank you very much. That was a very interesting talk. A lot there. So I'll just start things off. So how did you end up choosing neighbor joining?
Well, it was quite of the, I mean, given that we are computing distances anyway, neighbor joining was kind of a, wasn't that a, how do I say, like, that was the first thing that came to my mind, basically. You have a better suggestion?
Well, it's just interesting that you work very hard to calculate minimum distances. Yeah, I don't know.
Ideally, you want to use it as a starting point, and then later do some pruning and regrafting or nearest neighbor interchange to see whether you can actually still reduce the distances, the overall tree length that you get out of our reconstruction.
That would be really cool.
That was actually something we are planning on doing but haven't implemented yet. But yes, originally I just wanted to use the neighbor joining as kind of the starting tree and then follow up with, you know, like exactly what I just said, the trying to optimize the tree length further.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe in version 2.0.
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously what you're doing already is very complicated.
Yeah, took a while.
I was also interested that you you found it useful to both use the principal components projection and the tree in parallel. I guess the principal components has the advantage that you don't have to enforce a tree-like structure.
Yes, exactly. We tried a couple of things, and so first of all, the reason why we only use two principal components is that many of the spatial statistics techniques for detecting this local spatial clustering come from geology or ecology, and they typically only work in two dimensions. And we realized that actually a lot of the variance is already covered in the first two dimensions anyway. So this does not seem to be the problem. Why not use the tree directly? There was for a while a discussion about whether a tree is an adequate model to represent the evolution in cancer in the first place. That kind of leads a little bit into this whole discussion about the cancer stem cells. You know, that there might just be a single clone that radially emits all the samples.
But still, you could have a large multiplication at the beginning, right?
Yeah, you could have that, but I discussed with some colleagues. We wanted to kind of, didn't want to fix ourselves on the assumption that this is actually has to be a nicely branched tree. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Also, then you're kind of, once you have a mistake in your branching, it's just neighbor joining, right? I mean, it depends on how you define heterogeneity on the tree then, but I felt that it might be, you know, kind of, if you have an error in your tree reconstruction, this might influence your later results as well. So we purposefully chose to have a method that is more based on the distance itself than on the tree, especially because we have this nice embedding, you know, because implicitly we are already projecting our genomes into the mutational landscape anyway. So this was kind of, yeah, I thought it was...
No, I mean, it's definitely nice.
The most natural thing to do.
yeah, for sure. What about scaling this up? Like, I mean, obviously you guys have a really cool method, and you've done some nice things with it, but, I mean, kind of building on the previous talk, it would be really interesting to see if you can answer some of these questions about how cancer develops using these methods.
So you mean more in a prospective way? Because we at the moment had samples taken after surgery as well. And of course, the problem is a little bit, you need a certain number of samples in order to be able to reconstruct a tree. So if you only have one or two biopsies, ideally, you want to make a prediction about resistance development at that point, but with the way we did it in this clinical study, at least, this is not currently possible.
Yeah, but that's, I mean, I guess, so the sort of thing that the last speaker was talking about was things like you just showed in this early example, is like, is the kind of recurrent or, you know, nasty clone, does it exist at the very beginning of the tumor, or is it something that develops sort of subsequent
right.
to other mutations?
Yeah. So in this one case where we could actually show that it was already present at presentation, we are very sure that it did not develop. I think given the amount of time that the cancer had to evolve before onset of treatment, it is unlikely, but I wouldn't say it's impossible. But that would be a very interesting question to answer, I agree.
But like you say, I mean, it's going to require, each one is going to require lots of samples, so
yeah,
that might be daunting.
You could probably increase the number of samples. If there was a good way of calling a subclonal copy number profiles from SNP arrays or from sequencing, that would increase the number of samples available for reconstruction, right? Because instead of using kind of the dominant clone for each physical sample, which is basically what we're getting out of the SNP arrays at the moment, if you got like a subclonal, say a major clone and a subclone out of each physical sample, that would already double the number of samples that you have, which would probably help a lot.
Mm-hmm.
We're working on that currently.
Cool. I was just like, maybe this is just a little clarification, but I was a little confused. So at the very beginning of the talk, you had this diagram where you were talking about there are some clones that get selected and others that die off.
Yeah, shall I bring it on again?
Well, if you want. But I guess, so and then you said after that, you said if you see sort of spatially separated clones, then that implies selection. Did I mishear you?
I should be careful what I'm saying now, probably. What I meant was that if there are subpopulations that have a fitness advantage, they're less likely to die once chemotherapy sets in. So those that share this fitness-increasing mutation will be more closely related to each other, and therefore we see these clusters. I purposefully haven't used the word selection now.
Okay, I must...
There will be a variety of population geneticists out there that are going to crucify me later.
What's the sort of standard dynamic range that you guys have in your distances? Like, how big and how small can they get? I mean, I know that there's a lot of duplication that happens in cancer, but it's still sort of a few, right?
No, in ovarian cancer, it's a lot, actually. We had something between 10 and 100 events, as in maximum tree length from the diploid down to the leaf node.
Wow.
Which, along the whole genome, I mean, right? Like, the full genome length.
Uh-huh.
And I was wondering myself whether this is an overestimation, but actually, if you see that, for example, if you remember this slide with the NF1 deletion, which was really tiny,
mm-hmm.
a lot of these events actually happen in ovarian cancer, and you have a lot of overlapping large-scale rearrangements as well, and these copy number profiles, they really look very skewed and rugged, so we don't think it is a massive overestimation, at least.
Hmm. Wow.
Well, if you think of the whole chromothripsis debate as well, right, like, where the whole genome is supposed to be shattered into these in this one catastrophic event, and these copy number profiles look really crazy as well. And if you then would actually start to count the events that you would need to explain that, you would probably end up in the hundreds as well.
Wait, so do you think that those actually do represent a chromothrip?
I don't think that's the case in ovarian cancer, actually. We talked about that. There is still an ongoing debate as well, but it seems not to be the case from what I know, but yeah.
Yeah, that would make reconstruction a little bit more difficult.
Yeah, I mean, would it? I'm not sure. I mean, if all the clones that are related then share the same set of, you know, this catastrophic outcomes of this catastrophic events, they would still be more similar to each other than they would be to the rest. So probably you would still, you would have a very long branch at the beginning,
yeah,
which says 5 million, where it actually should say 1, but then the rest should still be arrived, I guess. At least ideally, in theory. But I haven't really applied it to any chromothripsis data yet to see what happens. It was kind of the assumption that, you know, it is a gradual process of accumulating genomic rearrangements, just like in traditional evolution.
Right. Cool. Well, I don't see any questions, so I'm out of questions, so thank you very much for your amazing talk.
Thanks, Vlad. Thanks for having me.
And I'm currently organizing the next set of talks, but I hope to announce it in about a month. All right. Thanks.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Bye.